Hello, welcome to the Learning Curve. I'm Marjorie Began. It seems like every day in the news we hear of people saving lives through heroic acts. But there are others we never hear of, those who give the gift of life, the blood donors. Here to talk with us about the gift of life is Allison Barraza from the American Red Cross. Welcome, Allison.
Thank you, Marjorie. Thanks for having me here.
You know, there's a seems to be a distinction between blood and platelets. I was reading and I was saying, I don't think most people know what that distinction is. Can you talk about it?
Right, absolutely. Well, first, to start off, when you say heroic acts, all these blood donors, whether they're blood donors or platelet donors, they are heroes. They're helping to save lives every single day. And with that one donation, you can help save up to three lives through the blood that you donate and the blood products. And that's what a platelet is. It's one of those blood products. Whole blood, of course, we know that's your typical donation that you would see out at your community blood drive. And that blood is going to help patients in need, and we can talk about that further. But the platelets are a key clotting component. So they're actually helped to help clot the blood. And they're really key in treatments of cancer patients and that sort of thing. So they have a very short shelf life, only 5 days. So we need those platelet donors. Yes, we can extract them from the blood that is drawn at these community blood drives. But if you come into one of our donation centers nearby, that's where you can actually do a platelet donation. It takes a little longer, but you're helping to save those cancer patients and help them further their treatment by those helping with that key clotting component in the blood.
I never realized that that was just a separate donation, and you would have to go to a different location for
Yes,
that.
that because that's a little more intricate, it could take up to 2 to 3 hours actually. But it's an automated kind of a machine that's actually going to draw out the platelets, leave the blood, but draw out the platelets out of your blood and take that out. And we talk about our heroes all the time, these platelet donors, these repeat platelet donors that make that commitment. You can donate platelets every 7 days for up to 24 times a year. And that's really critical because, like we said, there's only a 5-day shelf life, so those are needed constantly.
I see. So once they extract the platelets, is there a longer recovery time, let's say, from when you don't, because I know when you donate blood, you sit around for maybe a half an hour, 20
Sure.
minutes to
It's
make
a great
sure.
question. Look, we always want to make sure that you're feeling well afterwards. We're going to help, just let make you just hang out just for a little bit, get that juice, get that water, hydrate, and just, get a snack in you just so you're feeling okay. But it takes a little longer of a process, but the recovery time is just the same.
Oh, okay, great. Now, how often is blood needed?
Well, for the Red Cross, I can tell you that every 2 seconds, someone in the U.S. needs blood. It can't be manufactured. It has to come from volunteer donors around the U.S. And every 2 seconds, something happens where someone does require a blood product. And that could be someone who's involved in a car crash, a trauma situation, where blood, many units of blood could be needed for just one car crash victim, burn victims. Cancer patients, like we just spoke about, heart surgery patients require a lot of blood during that surgery, and also organ transplant recipients during their surgery. Those surgeries, they do require blood products that need to be readily available in the operating room. So every 2 seconds, for no matter what kind of reason, someone in the U.S. needs blood.
Once the blood is collected, where does it go?
It goes through extensive testing. So once it leaves the donation site, whether it be out in the community or out at one of our donation centers, it's headed for a national testing facility where we go ahead overnight. It's sent right away. It goes through extensive testing for a myriad of different conditions, make sure that it's safe as possible to be administered to a patient in need, whether that be in our region. Obviously, we prioritize our local hospitals, but if it's needed across the country, we have the ability to do that too. So as soon as it's taken and collected, it's going right to that testing facility and then right out to the hospitals we serve.
So it is transported, you might say, cold, or how is
Has
that
to be,
test
has to be, oh yes,
refrigerated?
refrigerate, absolutely, yes. It's kept at a certain temperature to make it as safe as possible for transport. And then again, it's going through all of these constant testings. And then as soon as it's gone through that extensive testing, it's being cold transported again back out to the hospitals and stored in those hospitals so doctors are able to grab it, whether it's in the operating room, the emergency room for trauma victims, that sort of thing.
So we said that the platelets have a life expectancy of five days.
That's it.
What about the blood?
42 days for whole blood. Uh-huh. Yep, it has a 42-day shelf life. So, you know, that's why we say the need for blood is constant. We need to continue to have those regular blood donors come in so that that inventory is always ready to go on hand when it's needed the most. Because of that shelf life, we say, you know, in an emergency situation, it's the blood on the shelves right now that's going to help in the emergency tomorrow. When there is a trauma situation, doctors have to run and get blood that's already there on the shelves. So that's why we need to constantly replenish it because of those shelf lives.
Mm, I see. Now, are there certain types of blood that are needed more than others?
We recommend, I mean, all blood donors of all blood types are needed at all different times of the year. We are all unique, and everybody needs a different type of blood. So we request that, you know, if you are going to come forward, it doesn't matter what type of blood you have. We need it all the time. So all blood types are needed at all times. However, I will tell you, less than 7% of the population in the country is O negative. And that is a rare blood type. O positive is our most common. O negative is the most uncommon. But the thing about O negative is that it can be administered to just about anyone. It's a universal blood type. So in one of those emergency situations, in a trauma situation where there may not be time to match the patient's type of blood, a doctor could reach for O negative in that split second decision and help that patient when seconds count and there isn't a lot of time. So yes, we encourage all blood donors of all types to please come on in and donate if you can. But of course, those O negative donors, we want to let you know that you're part of our trauma team and that we welcome you at any time as well.
I never knew there was a universal blood type.
Yeah, just about anyone. It can be administered to just about anybody. And it's what ER doctors talk about a lot in the emergency room, is that it's really important to have blood available, but if seconds count and there isn't much time, they know they can reach for that O negative to help a patient in need.
That's really good to know. Mm. Now, is there a particular time of year that seems to be more challenging for you to be collecting blood?
Great question. Yes. There are a couple times of year. We're in the winter time right now. During the winter, it can be more challenging to collect. It starts with the holiday season. People are busy during the holiday season. They're less available to give. They may be on vacation away from home, so they're not, those regular blood donors aren't making the appointments that they usually do. So it starts with that. In the winter time, it's also cold and flu season. So if you are sick, we'll have to ask you to defer to a time when you're feeling better. So, you know, because of cold and flu season, that adds up. And then also winter weather. Sometimes, unfortunately, when the snow comes in, it forces us to cancel blood drives in the community. And if it's not safe for donors or our staff to make it to these drives, unfortunately, have to be canceled. And those expected donation collections are going to go uncollected. So that kind of adds to a shortage that we typically see around this time of year. Also in the summertime as well. That's another time with similar situation where, you know, people are on the road, they're on vacation, they're away from home, schools and colleges are out of session, and we hold a lot of blood drives there. So the summer can also be a challenge as well.
Mm-hmm. How many people usually donate blood?
Well, 38% of the population in our country are eligible to donate, but only less than 10% actually do. So it's a pretty staggering number, and that's why we are so grateful to our repeat donors that always make that commitment to donate every 56 days when that's the time frame that you can donate whole blood or platelets. It's so important to keep that inventory high, but less than 10% actually do donate. And a lot of people, you know, when we ask, you know, why don't you donate, never really thought about it. So the more that we can explain the situation and how you're really helping to save patients in need, the more people we hope will make it a regular commitment.
Because that percentage is rather staggering.
Yeah.
You know, 10% of the population.
Less than 10, yeah.
Wow, my goodness.
Yeah.
Okay, so what are the basic eligibility requirements for donating?
You must be 110 pounds and at least 17 years of age. So that is the starting point. So that's from there we can kind of jump to when we go through the explain the donation process. They're going to give you a questionnaire, you know, that sort of thing. Your iron levels are going to determine if you're able to give, your blood pressure check at that moment of donation. So other things could play into it as you go further into the registration process at a drive, but the first things that we must have are at least 17 years of old and 110 pounds.
Mm. Oh, so what is the actual donation process like?
From start to finish, we ask if you can just carve out 1 hour of your time. First things first, as long as that those two requirements right there check out, our wonderful volunteer staff at the registration table is going to give you some reading to just take a peek at. The reading changes a lot depending on different, you know, situations, travel bans, that sort of thing. And if you go through that reading and you say, yes, none of this applies to me, I'm good to go, let that volunteer know. They're going to give you a number and a time, a sticker, fancy sticker. And you'll go into the next process where one of our wonderful phlebotomists and nurses will come over to you, bring you to a confidential health history area. And that's a confidential process that you'll go through with our staff. That's where they'll give you your iron check and your blood pressure check. So it's great to get a little mini, you know, a little mini health checkup just to see how you're doing.
Sure.
If that checks out, and you'll go ahead and answer a questionnaire that's confidential. If everything checks out, then we'll go ahead and we'll get you on one of our donation beds. And the actual blood draw only takes about 10, 15 minutes tops. It's painless. We have a wonderful staff who makes you as comfortable as possible. It's only a few minutes. And they'll make it as easy as possible for you. And then once you're done there, we want to make sure that you're replenished, that you're feeling okay. So that is where we go over to the canteen. We have great snacks, we have juice, we have water, and our staff will be there to make sure you're doing okay. And we'll make sure that you're feeling good to go. Sit there for, you know, 10 minutes if you can. Make sure that you're feeling okay, and then that's it. So
I must admit, I think 2 years ago was the first time I ever donated. And I was a little nervous,
sure,
you know,
yeah.
Going in, didn't know what to expect.
Mm-hmm.
But I was extremely pleasantly surprised that it was as easy as it was, you know. And I have a little fear of needles, but it was really, as you said, it was very painless. And the staff was wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
So the process really is an easy process.
It is, and sometimes at our drives we're so grateful to have blood recipients that join us at these drives. So you're seeing the faces of the people that you're helping with your donation, and it's been a privilege for me to be able to meet these people out at and during in my position, and to see the people that have been helped through the cancer patients that have had transfusions, or the car crash victims, or the trauma victims, that, you know, some of people I've met have required 46 units of blood to survive the ordeal that they had been in that put them in that situation. So when you see the faces of the people that you're helping, and again, you can help save up to 3 lives with that one donation. So it's pretty remarkable.
Mm, absolutely. So how does one find out about donating and where to go?
We make it as easy as possible for you. So the first thing I can tell you to do is visit redcrossblood.org. That has everything you need to know about how to donate, frequently asked questions, eligibility questions, faces of the people, stories of the people that you'd be helping. It also has a search box, so you can put in your zip code, and that's where it will bring up a long list of the upcoming drives in your area. And you can hit the search radius, whether it's 10 miles, 25 miles, however long you'd be willing to travel, what's in your area in the upcoming few weeks. That's where you can find it, and you can book your appointment right there. You can also call 1-800-RED-CROSS to book an appointment. They'll find the closest drive to you that's an upcoming drive, and you can book it that way. And also, we're encouraging people to download our blood donor app. It's free. You can get it on iTunes or the Google Play Store, and it's free to download. You can find a donation site, find a drive, book that appointment, and you can track kind of, you know, where afterwards they're going to show you where your blood actually went, which hospital it actually went to. There are rewards on there, kind of badges that you can earn. So it's a really fun interactive app, and we really encourage people to download that as well.
Oh, excellent. And for the people here in Mansfield, we do put it on our community bulletin board when there is a Mansfield donation going on. And we try to run our PSA to let people know that it's coming up, you know.
Yeah.
So we've been trying to do what we can, you know, to promote this, because it really is a gift of life.
And we certainly appreciate all of your support and the Mansfield community support. I know that you do run a couple of blood drives here every so often here in the community, and those drives that are always on the books that we can count on, we really certainly appreciate.
Well, that's great. I'm glad Mansfield can help.
Go Mansfield.
Exactly. Well, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
I really do appreciate it.
Thank you.
And if there's anything more in the future you want to say, please come.
I will be here. Thank you, Marjorie.
And thank you for being with us today. And we look forward to seeing you next time.